awesome presentation. You've inspired me to reconsider. Maybe I'll lay out again.
That's good. That was the goal, I guess.
Yeah. Awesome.
Sorry I took all the presentation.
It's okay. I might go over by a little bit. So I'm going to talk today about decoupling your tests from your implementation. Is there anybody in here who's doing testing on their projects? We've got a few. Okay, awesome. Anybody doing TDD, test driven development? Yeah, we've got a few. Okay, awesome. So my name is Derek. I've been working at Pivotal Labs for the last couple of years, not just doing iOS development, but doing some full stack development, Swift, some Java, some JavaScript, some React. And through this experience, I've learned a lot about testing and kind of the pitfalls of testing, and I'm trying to get better at testing and refactoring and specifically focusing on creating test suites that are decoupled from the implementation. And I've learned a couple things about this that I'd like to share with everybody today. And just to caveat this, what I'm about to show you isn't something I'm promoting as like, this is the only way to do things, or this is the best way to do things. Testing and test suites and implementation, it's all an experiment. These are things I'm experimenting with. I encourage you to experiment with them and see if this kind of approach works for you, or if there are maybe ways in which we can improve upon it or try different things. Or as Matt suggested, even for auto layout or manual layout, there are certain cases in which you may want to use one tool versus another. So this is really about building a toolbox, so we have a variety of tools that we can use for the patterns that we encounter, for solving them in an effective way. All right, I'm going to kick this off with just a few slides before I start coding and talk to you about why I'm doing testing and why I'm doing TDD and why it's important. And I'm gonna fly through these so we can get to the coding, which is really the fun part. And so essentially with software development, it doesn't really matter what kind of software development we're doing, if it's an iOS app or if it's an Android app or if it's a website or whatever it is. The ideal thing is we really wanna go fast. We wanna write code and we wanna have fun writing code and we wanna do it quickly. We wanna write something and we wanna see something happen and we wanna move on to the next thing. This is really like the goal of what we wanna do as developers. And in order to do that, we need to have clean code. Because if we don't have clean code, we're gonna spend most of our time trying to figure out what the code is doing, and you know, code that's difficult to understand is going to slow us down, and we don't want to get slowed down. So making sure our code is clean is something that should be a habit for us to do, not just something that we say, okay, well, Friday afternoons we're going to do some cleaning up of our code. And it's like it's a constant thing. And for anybody who's familiar with the solid principles, object-oriented design patterns, these things also help us with clean code as well. The process that helps us get to clean code is refactoring. So the very first time we write anything isn't necessarily going to be the most beautiful thing that we write. It doesn't matter if it's a presentation, or if it's a blog post, or if it's a book, or if it's code. We're writing, we're authors, we have an audience, and in order to get that to a cleaner state, we need to do some refactoring. That could be changing a method name, that could be extracting a method, it could be any little type of refactoring to larger types of refactorings. And that's what helps us to keep, you know, the code clean and conforming to these principles. So if we have the ability to refactor, then we have confidence that we have working software for our users, and really that's what we want. Like, our end user is the person who we're building this for. We want to have confidence that what we're doing is working for them. We could also talk about things like continuous integration, which runs our tests and gives us confidence. But in order to have confidence, we need to have tests, because we're refactoring without tests. We don't know if we've broken something. We may have broken something that we have no idea that we've broken. So in order to get confidence, we have to have tests. And if we have to write tests in order to get confidence so that we can refactor and we can have clean code and go fast forever, that means everything is depending on the fact that we have a suite of tests. And so that's why we write our tests first. Start with the test, and this gives us the ability to do everything else, because everything depends on tests. So this is kind of the fundamental reason in which why I'm doing testing, which why I'm doing test-driven development. and why I believe it's really important. And I can't take credit for this. This overview here was done by a gentleman named Matt Parker. He is the head of engineering at Pivotal Labs, and he gave a talk at Spring One Platform Conference last year called TBD, The Bad Parts, where he talks about this. So if you'd like some more detail about that, I highly recommend you do that. And so from Uncle Bob, just the three reasons why he feels like the act of writing a test is important. First is because it's an act of design. You're thinking about what it is you're going to write before you actually write the code. You're doing design as you're doing it on demand. You're also creating documentation that's executable. It's a spec. So you can actually look at this now or later. Your team can look at it, and read it, understand what's going on, and you can run it. And it'll tell you if it's working or not. And then lastly, for verification. And Uncle Bob actually says that verification is really like the least reason, the least important reason why we're writing tests. Yes, it gives us verification of what we're doing, not just now as we've completed it, but in the future, you know, to make sure we haven't broken something that we've already done. But really, this is the least important reason of the three in terms of the reasons why we're writing tests. So it's a really quick overview. The goal that I have for today is that I really want to illustrate how tests can be coupled to your implementation details. And we're going to start off with writing a test that does this. When testing specifically some user interface components in Swift. So what I want to do is I want to help illustrate how you can decouple some of these implementation details from your tests. I'm also going to show you how you can make your tests a little bit more readable, make them a little bit more read like a spec, like documentation, and make it easier for other people to understand, and also be a little bit more concise, a little bit more succinct, so that you're not bogged down with details that aren't necessarily relative to what you're trying to test. I'm going to do this. Coding. I haven't done this before, so I'm a little nervous. Okay, so let's jump over to Xcode. Interesting. So now I am going to have to mirror my screen so you can see what's going on. That's great. Get this microphone into a comfortable position so I don't have to move very much while I do this. This screen is huge. Okay. So now the question is, presentation or presentation large? Maybe we start with presentation large and see how difficult the code is to work with. Everybody can see that though, right? Yeah. Okay. All right. So we're going to start by writing a test. I'm going to use the typical process I would use for TDD. And that's, we're going to do red, green, refactor. We're going to write a failing test. Then we're going to make it pass. Then we're going to refactor. Uncle Bob has three rules of test-driven development that he likes to follow, and I'm going to operate using those today. First one is you're not allowed to write any production code unless it is to make a failing unit test pass. The second one is you're not allowed to write any more of a unit test than is sufficient for it to fail, and not compiling is considered a failure. And then lastly, you're not allowed to write any more production code than is sufficient to pass the one failing unit test that you're writing. So we are going to create a new unit test class, and I'm going to call this the logon view controller. We'll call it a spec. We're going to do this in Swift, and we're not going to create a bridging header for this. And I'm going to start by deleting all this code and starting with a live template with a template here that we have, and we're going to call this the logon view controller. Actually, let's call this a spec. It's quick spec. So I'm using Quick here, and I'm using Nimble. Quick is a BDD testing framework, and Nimble is an assertion framework. And I've been experimenting with this over using XCTest because I think it's a little bit nicer to focus on behavior-driven development as opposed to unit tests, specifically like unit tests. I like the ability to describe things that are going on. So we're going to describe the logon screen here. And for the logon screen, we are going to confirm that we're just, that it displays a button, logon button, let's say. Logon button. Okay, and in order to do that, we're gonna need a view controller. So I'm going to new up a new logon view controller. View controller. And of course this doesn't compile, right? Because we don't have a logon view controller. Okay, so let's go over here and let's create a logon view controller. Logon view controller.swift. And yeah, we'll replace that old one because it should have been there in the first place. And yeah, we're gonna need to import UIKit in order to do this. And we're going to create a new class, logon view controller. This is going to inherit from UI view controller. Okay, so this should compile now since we have created our logon view controller. And yeah, thanks. So Xcode is gonna like display some crazy errors because it, for some reason, can't always like get rid of the errors. I don't know. Something, it's a present that they gave us with Xcode 9. We're not using a logon view controller yet, so we're going to use the logon view controller. We're going to say, okay, logon button, dot, well, let's say let logon button equals logon view controller dot logon button. And of course, this isn't going to compile either. So let's create a logon button. Logon button, UI button. And probably gonna need to initialize this. So we're gonna create an initializer here, but we don't need to really do too much with it yet. Logon button equals UI button. And this is going to be type system button. And we need to call a super init function, because if we don't do that, Swift will be unhappy. And that should be good. And we also need a default initializer. And I'm just going to have Xcode add that for me. Thank you. Okay, so we are compiling now. So we can jump back to our test and compile our test. And all right, good. Now we're going to get into our expectation. We're going to expect logon button dot title label dot text to equal logon. Okay, great. Wish there was a way. Maybe it would have been better to change the spacing here, but we can kind of see this okay for now. All right, so this test exhibits the three components a test should have set up. We've got setup, we've got an action, and we have an expectation. And this is assert, act, or arrange, act, assert. We're going to talk about this in test form. And so now I can run this test, and this should fail. Failing test. Yeah. All right. Woo. All right, good. Now we can write some code, finally. All right, so I'm gonna write a configure views method here just to keep this simple and make a file private extension for my logon view controller and put a func configure views in here and logon button dot set title, okay, title logon for state normal and is there anything else we need to do for this? I don't know. Maybe this is okay. We'll run our test. Alright. Test passes. Woo! Red green.
Yeah.
There it is. Okay. So I mean we could do some refactoring here. I'm going to let me bring this down to presentation. Can you still see that all okay? Yeah? I see heads nodding. Okay. All right. Let's do it here. So I've purposely put two spaces between the arrange and the action and the assert. This just helps to call out what the action is. But to be honest, we don't really need to pull this out into a separate variable. We can just do that here like that. And I think that should be fine. Logon view controller button title label. Okay, so I'm pretty happy with this test, so I think I'm gonna Hey, I'm gonna write another test. Let me check my notes here. Yeah. Okay. All right. Good. So we're gonna write another test, and the next test that I want to write is that when we tap this button, that it actually does something. And this is, I think this is a really common thing that we need to do for testing. So we're going to call the authentication service when tapping the log on button. And we're gonna need a log on view controller again. And yes, I am duplicating code, but that's okay. We'll clean this up afterwards. And I wanna tap this button, so I'm going to say log on view controller dot log on button dot send actions for touch up inside, right? Because this, of course, naturally means that we're gonna tap the button, right? We're gonna send an action for touch up inside, and that this is pretty standard stuff. So now we're gonna expect that our authentication, authenticator, let's call authenticator spy, logon was called to be true, to be true. Okay, and now this isn't gonna compile because I don't have an authenticator spy. So this is a bonus. You get a bonus dependency injection lesson today. So this is gonna be fun. We have a bonus for some dependency injection. So let's create an authenticator spy, and we're just gonna call that authenticator spy. And of course this doesn't exist either, so we're gonna have to create that. I'm gonna just create all of this stuff inside the test because it just makes it that much easier for this demo, but of course I would actually pull this out into a separate file and yada yada. So this is going to be a class authenticator spy, and this has got a conformity protocol called authenticator, which of course doesn't exist yet either. So we're gonna have to create the authenticator protocol, and this is just gonna have a function on it called logon. So now we can come in here, we can say function logon. And in here, we're going to say, not authenticator spy, we're gonna say logon was called equals true. And this is going to be defined here as a variable, logon was called equals false. So I'm not gonna get into the details of this, but this is essentially a type of test double that we call a spy. And I'm not actually going to be using the actual authenticator within the view controller test, because we're not testing the authenticator. We're not testing the thing that actually does the authentication for us. We just want to test that it was called. So we're gonna pass in this test double. It's gonna act as if it were the authenticator, and afterwards we're gonna query it and say, hey, were you called or not when I tapped this button? And it's gonna say yes or no. Either it was called or it wasn't called. So that is essentially what this code here is doing. So we've newed up our authenticator spy here, but we need to pass it into our view controller. So we're going to say authenticator is going to take an authenticator spy. And of course, now this isn't going to compile because our view controller doesn't take that in as a parameter. So we're going to come to our initialization method here. We're going to take authenticator, and you're going to conform to the authenticator protocol, which of course this doesn't exist either because it's in the test. So let's just take it from the test and move it over here into the code, and we can compile our code, finally compile our test. Build failed logon view controller. Okay, so this is really interesting. So the logon view controller, I can't create a new instance of this now without passing in an authenticator. And my test, my first test is expecting that to have an authenticator. So I'm going to mark this as optional and initialize it to nil to get around this for right now. This is something I've been experimenting with dependency injection, is not actually being explicit with what the requirement is, because I think it's okay for it to be nil, and this removes the dependency out of the test instances where you actually don't need this. Like, it's not important to what we're testing right now. And now if we all look at this, you can see it says build succeeded and Xcode is giving these ghost errors. So we'll just ignore those for right now. And we're gonna run our tests. And hopefully we should have a failing test at this point. Test failed, okay, awesome. So we created an instance of our logon view controller and we passed it our authenticator spy. And we tapped the button, and we expected log on was called to be true. And if we close that side window, you can say expected to be true, got false. So it wasn't actually called. OK, so let's call it. So in order to call it, we need to add a target action, right, for our button. So when we tap our button, it actually does something. And let's see, I'm going to mark this as view setup, and I'm going to create a mark for, we're going to call these actions. This can't be file private, so just make an extension for log on view controller. Nice and separate this out. Oh, and this has to be an at objc, right? Otherwise, we can't actually connect it. Did tap log on button. All right, and this is going to have a sender UI button, probably. Okay, so now that we've got our function defined, in our configure views, we'll say log on button dot. What is it set? Target action, add target action. Okay, add target self. And our action is going to be pound selector. And did tap. There you are. Okay, great. We're going to put you down there. For touch up. No love, Xcode. Touch up inside. Okay. So we are adding our target to the button, and we've defined our method. And now we need to do something with the authenticator, but we don't have it yet. So all right, let's grab that authenticator. We're going to need to hold on to that locally. So let authenticator be an authenticator. I like to do this. I like to put my properties, kind of the properties that I expect to be setting at the very top of the file, and then any type of UI elements afterwards, and then like mark initialization here. So we've got initialization. Okay, so let's hold on to that authenticator equals authenticator. And of course, if I don't do self dot, I won't know which one I'm talking about. So we are holding on to our authenticator. So now we can actually come down to our action, authenticator dot logon. And you're optional, right? Yeah, you should be optional, because I may or may not get you. All right, we compile, build succeeded, and let's run our test one more time. Drum roll, please. Test succeeded. All right. This is the smoothest live coding I've ever done in my life. Okay, so I'd like to take a break here in my red-green refactor step and get to the fun part, refactoring. Refactoring is the reward for having written your tests, as Uncle Bob likes to say. So I'd like to clean up this just a little bit, because there are a couple things that I don't particularly care about. I don't really like this send action for touch up inside. Like, if you haven't actually coded touching, you know, doing the touch events in this manner, you may not have any idea what is going on here. And I'd really like to do this in a different way. I'd like to say something like tap. You know, I want to tap this button. So this is easy to do with an extension on UI button. And we can just define a function called tap. And this is really easy because it just says send actions, touch up inside. Okay, great. And now I can, of course, I could run my test again to confirm that this refactoring hasn't broken any of my functionality. And that's good. Okay, so that's good. The second thing that I noticed about this is that I've got some duplication here. I'm doing setup kind of in both places. And this can be pulled out. We're going to maybe grab these components here and bring them up here into a before each block. This is also something that anybody who's familiar with Qwik may be familiar with. So now we can pull those out up to here, but we're still going to need to define them outside as variables. And I would love to do this in AppCode because it would be a lot faster than Xcode. But we'll hang out here for a little while. And we're going to add bangs on the end of this. Trust me, I will be initializing them. That's good there. Okay, so we don't need these anymore. So the authenticator's fine. We're testing the logon view controller, so I'm going to bump that up to the top. We've got the authenticator spy, we're initializing the passing into our log on view controller. So now we've got both of these tests that are looking a little bit cleaner. Our setup is more explicit. It's being done in this before each, and should be able to run this test and see that it's still passing again. All right. Excellent. All right. So what are the problems that we have with this test right now? Does anybody see anything that's a problem with this test? Like, we want to refactor the implementation, but we can't because the tests are depending on something in the implementation. Are you seeing anything in there? Any ideas? So the one thing that jumps out at me is the log on button itself. We're like going straight from the view controller to the log on button, and we're asking it information about itself, and we're also tapping it directly. But this is a good test from the user's perspective. Like, this is definitely what the user would do. The user's gonna come to this screen and they're gonna tap on this button. But the fact that there is a log on button feels like a private detail, like an implementation detail of this to me. So what I'd like to do is try to figure out a way in which we can get around, like, actually accessing the log on button directly. Because right now, if I wanted to refactor this, say I wanted to just change the name of the log on button to something else. Say the developers had a big discussion and the designer was like, well, we're not going to call this the log on button, we're going to call this the log in button. They're like, okay, well, now we have to change the name, log on button, log in button. And as soon as I change that name in the implementation, I'm going to have to change my tests. And that's annoying, right? I don't want to change my tests just because I changed the name of something. My tests should be able to be segmented away from that. They should be protected from those types of changes. I brought my power outlet up here, and I totally forgot to plug it in. Okay, so what I'd like to do is figure out how we can actually pull this detail out of the test. And we're gonna do this just to start by saying, okay, log on button, you're now private. So if you're private to the view controller, of course the view controller is fine, but now we can't compile any code because we're accessing the log on button directly. Now, what do we have access to from our test if we don't have access to the log on button? Is there something else we have access to?
The methods?
The view controller. We have access to the view controller. So what's within the view controller?
The action method.
The action method. So the action method is on the view controller, but I also don't want to call that directly. If I call this method directly, that's also tying me to like an implementation detail that I feel like should be the concern of the implementer, however they want to implement that. But the view controller does have access to our view hierarchy. It has access to everything within that view hierarchy, and this log on button should be somewhere within that view hierarchy. So let's go digging. Let's go digging for a log on button within that view hierarchy. I'm going to comment out this top test to start, just because I want to focus on tapping right now, and this top test actually is going to become moot in a moment here. So I'm going to say let log on button be a UI button. Maybe it's a log on button, because we're going to go hunting for this log on button. We are going to do a for subview in log on view controller dot view dot subviews. Let's go digging for this thing. Okay, so for each view in these subviews, we're going to check and see if button, if let button, oh no, button, if button, let, yes. Sorry, if let button equals subview as UI button. So if we can cast this subview to a type of UI button, then we want to check to see if the button, no, not the, we should have a button in here, if button dot title label dot text is equal to logon, because we know the text of the button that we want to pull out, then we can say logon button equals button, and we can break out of this loop. And so if we do that, we can pull the view controller off of the logon button, because now we're not, we don't need the view controller to do that. And we can just say logon button dot tap. And it's used before it's being initialized, but that's okay because Xcode is forgetting to logon button dot tap. Technical difficulties. Okay. Logon button is maybe a UI button. Ah, I think you need to be a var. That's why you're unhappy. Maybe you're a logon button. Okay. Build succeeded. So we're going to dig through the view hierarchy, and we're going to find the button with the text that we want to have, and this test fails. Why does this test fail? The test fails. Does anybody have any idea why this test is failing? Let's look at the implementation. So we're configuring our views, no storyboard. We're setting the title and the logon button, and we're adding the target, but this button, this logon button, hasn't been added to the view hierarchy yet, right? So in the first test, where we're coupled to the implementation detail, we had a passing test that said there was a button in the view hierarchy. Well, that said that there was a button there that had the text logon in it, when the button wasn't even added to the view hierarchy yet, right? So like that's like a false positive that we encountered there. So if we come into the implementation here, view add subview logon button, actually put the button into the view hierarchy, then this test should pass, if I'm lucky. All right. So there's another good example of, well, you've got a passing test, which isn't actually giving you confidence that your code is doing what you expect it to do. We thought we had a button in our hierarchy, and we didn't actually have it in there. So the test wasn't really giving us the confidence that we wanted to have in that. Now that we're looking for the button based on what the text is, this first test is not really needed anymore, so we can delete that. Deleting code is fun. Love to delete code. And this is a really cool and interesting way to go digging through your view hierarchies to find things that are in there without caring where they are necessarily. So you can actually get confirmation. And now we're decoupled from the idea that there's even a logon button in the implementation. We're just saying, hey, find a button, and should have the text for logon in it. And we're going to go tap that button. And the other thing I really like about this is this helps to communicate what we're doing from the user's perspective. Like, the actual user is going to be going in and saying, looking for a button that says logon on it, and they're going to be tapping it. So this also reads a lot more like a use case, I think, than an actual unit test. You know, focusing on the behavior for that user. But this is also an eyesore, so I really want to pull this out here and pull it out into a separate function. We're going to call this like find button, and stick this in here as the find button. And so in order to find a button, we're going to need to look in a view, and we'll call this view. This will be a UI view. And we're also going to need to look at the text. We'll call this search text from our perspective, and this is a string. And this changes as follows. We no longer need the view controller to loop through the subviews here, and the search text is going to become our search text, what we passed in. And this also changes a little bit now, because now we can just say return button, we don't have to break, and this is going to need to return a UI button, maybe return a UI button, and otherwise it's going to return nil. Okay, great. So now var logon button can be set to find button. And where are we going to look for it? We're going to look for it in our logon view controller. Dot view with text logon. And Hopefully I can rerun this test and have this test pass. Okay, great. So that refactoring also went pretty well. Awesome. Now, I like this, but one of the things that I've become increasingly aware of as I've been writing a little bit more code in Swift lately, the last month or so, is that I see a lot of helper functions and helper classes, and like we build these helpers and like toolbox kind of, you know, classes that we, where are my notes? We build all these types of helpers and things that we stick these types of functions in, and when in actuality, it helps if we can associate them with whatever model object or whatever it is they're working on. And if you ever find yourself in a situation where you've got these types of helper functions and you're not sure where to put it, so you put it in X, Y, Z helper, then stop and look at the method signature and what you're passing into it and see if there's some place where you can move it in relation to that. And this, to me, is related to the UI view. This is very similar to what Matt was doing in his previous talk. So I'm going to create an extension on UI view, and I'm going to move this down there. So now I can find a button within my UI view. I can delete this first parameter because I don't need it. I no longer need to say in view.subviews. I can just say in subviews because that's where we are. And the rest of this, I believe, doesn't really change except for the caller here. So now we don't need to specify where we're doing it. We're just saying find button with text off of the logon view controller dot view dot find button with text. Okay. Build succeeded. And testing is a little slow in iOS. Okay, great. So I'm going to take this and I'm going to bump it up one more notch, and I'm going to create an extension on UI view controller. And for this, I'm going to call it tap button, because I feel like we can even make this a little bit more succinct. And within tap button, what we're going to do is we're going to give it some text. And this is going to be the search text as a string. And so we're on the view controller now. So we have access to the views. So now we can say if let button equals view.find button. View is my view, view.find button with text, search text. Then we can just say button tap. Awesome. All right. So now, instead of logon button.tap, we can actually just say logon view controller, tap button with text, logon, and the rest of this goes away. And we can run our test. And our test passes. All right, so we're running a little low on time here. So instead of detailing instead of going through the next set of steps that I would plan on going through, I'm going to just kind of talk through some of them. I did all of this within like one test file and within one view controller file, but I would break these out into separate files, you know, put UIView extensions in their own place and, you know, make sure to clean that up in that regard. I'm sure one question that everybody has is, okay, well, this is great, but view hierarchies are generally a lot more complex than just putting things on your view controller's view. And actually, I don't recommend putting items on your view controller's view. I would recommend wrapping anything you have that you want to put in a view, not on the view controller, but within a container view. So create a view, put that on your view controller, and put the things in there that you need. In order to enhance this code to be able to do that, all you need is a little bit of recursion. So if we come through here and we find that our button is not within that subview initially, what we can do is we can say if our subview dot subviews, so subviews, not subviews, subview dot subviews dot count is greater than zero, then what we want to do is we want to call find button on our subview. So we can say if let button equals subview singular dot find button with text, search text, then this means we have our button here, we can return the button there. And so this gives us the ability to recursively go through our subview hierarchy. And if I had more time, what I would do is I would actually pull this logon button out into a subview and show an illustration of how we can do that. So now you can, not only are you not tied to the name logon button, but now you can put this button within your view hierarchy at any location and test and still confirm that it's there. And the reason why I think this is so great is because it gives you a lot of freedom to refactor and to have confidence in your tests, that your test is doing what you expect it to do, but you still have a lot of capability to refactor things out. Because if you move this button into a view, into a subview, right, you're going to have to also move this target action into that subview. And if your target action's in the subview, and that subview doesn't have an authenticator, then you're going to need to maybe use a delegate to tell that subview, you know, hey, view controller, this button was tapped. And you can implement that delegate, you can do all of that without changing your test, because it's an implementation detail that your test doesn't need to know about. And you still have confidence that your tests are doing what you want them to do. So I think this offers a number of different benefits. We've got nice readable test code here that says exactly kind of what we're doing. Our tests are decoupled from the implementation at this point. And it reads kind of like a user scenario with what we're doing. So these are kind of the highlights that I wanted to introduce and kind of show a couple examples of how we can do this with testing. Let's see, is there anything else? These are the kind of the main highlights for this one. I think that's it. So if we come back to the slides, what did we cover today? Really quick TDD stuff, red, green, refactor, the three laws of TDD, and within a single test, arrange, act, assert. We also talked a little bit about behavior-driven development using QWIC. Refactoring for clarity and readability. We want our code to be readable, we want it to be easily understood, so that when people read it besides us, or even our future selves, that it's easy to understand. And we talked about how to fold some of these helper functions into extensions, so that we're not creating XYZ helpers and things that, you know, what's in here? I'm not sure what's in here, since it's a helper. We talked about how to write some tests that are decoupled from the implementation. We showed a false positive, how a test could maybe give you some confidence that it was doing something you thought it was doing, but it actually wasn't. And as a bonus, we had an example of dependency injection using a type of test double called a spine, which is looking in to confirm kind of what was done with that object that was passed in, the test double that was passed in. So it's a lot of material, but we're running a little short on time. Questions?
I had one question. Yeah.
Okay. Ben?
I think this looks really cool. I think, my one question for you, given your love of tests, does it concern you that iterating through your subviews might need their own tests? And if so, have you considered maybe assigning the UIDs, just generating the UIDs for your views and storing those in a map or a dictionary? So that you could open them up by those UIDs very quickly rather than having to iterate through stuff. And the reason why I ask that is because if you had a test to check for the superview of the button, it would have caught that, but it didn't match. It would have been nil. And also the tap action probably wouldn't have worked anyways because it would have been deallocated because there was nothing holding a pointer to it for a strong reference.
Yep.
So those things would have failed, and then if you looked it up by its UID, I should know that it would have been retained by that. Let's use the map table. So anyway, if you put it in a map table, is that a better solution than looping through views? That's the big question.
I haven't experimented with that type of UUID and map table type of thing, but it sounds to me like a lot of complexity and a lot of work to maintain that kind of thing. But I do think you made a great point in terms of, don't you feel like you would have to have testing code around, you know, searching for your view hierarchy? And what I've started to do, and I haven't pushed this up to GitHub yet, but I've started to do just that. I'm working on maybe a framework called Succinct that I would like to use in order to test some of this logic. And so you can see here, I'm creating a view controller using a builder pattern, and adding a subview to it with a button that has text in it, and then confirming that I can find that button. And then I'm also creating another UI view controller with a subview in it that has another subview with a lock-on button in it. And this is my test for the code that goes through the subviews to confirm that it can find what is there. Because I totally agree, if you're writing test code that needs to be tested, then maybe you should do something with that. And I think a framework, something like this that could be used for helping you with your tests could be useful.
Yeah, I think like there's definitely some parts of the blue bank that make me a bit nervous. Like just an extreme case, let's say you added a view from another view controller has a subview on another controller that had a login button.
Yeah.
It might find that and then your test might pass for some reason.
Mm-hmm.
But it should.
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas if you're using the UIDs, it would, unless it was the same view controller and stuff, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But I hear you, so.
Yeah.
Test for tests.
Okay.
I really want to follow that up with just one question about, kind of related. You might be able to do exactly what you're describing already, UI accessibility, but I'm not 100% positive. But you can use accessibility to like give a label to views, and I think you can fuck out those views from a hierarchy, but I'm not 100%
sure. That's cool.
So that would be a thing that you could potentially achieve the same result.
Mm.
Worth investigating, because I'm not actually positive that that works, but I think it can be done.
My understanding is that's how the UI testing framework works for iOS. Now, I haven't really done much with that. The extent of my knowledge is that you need to assign an accessibility identifier.
You have to have an identifier.
Yeah, and then there's maybe an API in the UI testing framework that allows you to get access to that.
That'd be really cool to know.
So, yeah.
If you find anything out, can you let us know?
Yeah, I will personally email each and every one of you.
Yeah.
You got it.
Yeah.
You have one more question. Any other questions? Yeah. Okay.
Is there a way to say new code, test code?
Mm.
Is there a way to say it as a generic project case?
As a generic project case?
Yeah.
Like an Xcode?
Save.
Like an Xcode snippet?
Yes. This test code.
Mm.
But I hope generally project test.
Mm.
So,
it's easier.
Easy. Every day, easy project.
I think if you just keep using save, like generic, save as generic code, so you can keep using it over and over every day.
Mm.
Please.
Okay. Yeah, I'm working maybe on a framework to share with everybody, with not just buttons, but you know, labels and other ways to access this type of information.
My smart.
Thank you. All right, I have one more.
I think your talk is comprehensive and great, but I think you told one important thing. It's testing in iOS. It's pretty slow. I think this have any good practice to make the unit test pass in iOS?
We're living in a time where testing is taking off, and IDEs and stuff are kind of catching up. So the tooling for different languages and different tech stacks varies. I just got off a project where we were doing JavaScript, and we had about 2,000 tests running in JavaScript in a matter of seconds. So, you know, if we were just running a file of a couple tests, it didn't take any time at all. In fact, there are some live testing frameworks. I want to say it was maybe called Wallaby. There's like some live testing, like JavaScript. Like, it runs your tests in the background, so like literally as you're typing, it tells you if it's failing or if it's passing, which is amazing. I hate JavaScript, just for the record. I really hate JavaScript, but I love the testing. My God. Yeah, coming back to iOS after doing JavaScript for a year has been like painful from a testing perspective. So one thing that I do is from terminal, I create a makefile. You can do this too as well, which, let me make this a little bit bigger. Makefile that just has some things in it for Carthage, and then running unit tests here. And this is just using Xcode build, so I can say something like make tests and run it from the command line. And then this will also run easily from the CI system. This isn't necessarily faster per se, but at least for iOS testing, I tend to focus on the current test that I'm running and only the current test that I'm running. In XE test, you can do that by clicking on the little diamond next to the test. And in order to run the previous test that you ran, you can do smash or magic G. That's command option control plus G. So learning the keyboard shortcuts for executing just a specific test can be really useful. For quick, you can stick an F at the beginning of a describe block or an int block or a context block, and that puts focus on that part of the code and only runs that test or that block of the test. You just don't want to forget those before you check your code in. Otherwise, you may be forgetting to run the rest of your test suite. Those are the only tips that I have right now. Xcode really needs to kind of make some improvements. I think Apple and Xcode needs to make some improvements to make it easier to do testing in Swift and iOS platforms. Sure. All right, I think we're good. We're a little bit over time, so let's jump back into some slides. Thank you. Thank you for your attention. If you want to catch me on Twitter, I'm getting out.